Hello everyone, I am Professor Kiran Mali Patil from KLE Engineering College, Belagavi. Today we will discuss about module 4, that is energy principles and energy theorems. So already in the previous lectures we have discussed the module 3, that is deflection of beams, wherein you have studied about the conjugate beam method and moment area method to find the slope and deflection for determinate beams subjected to different types of loading. So in continuation with the module 3, so now we will be discussing the module 4, wherein you will be finding again the deflections of determinate structures by energy principles and energy theorems. Okay, these are the outlines where we will be studying in this module: deflection of determinate structures by strain energy method, it is also called as real work method; unit load method, that is also called as virtual work method; then Castiglione's theorems; derivations, that is strain energy due to axial force, bending moment, shear force and torsion. Okay, so here you will be studying the strain energy, complementary strain energy, virtual work, real work. So unit load method, strain energy method, Castiglione's theorem methods. Okay, so ultimately we will be finding the deflection for determinate structures. So total three methods you will be learning: strain energy method, unit load method and Castiglione's theorems. So first let us look into energy principles. What is the application of this energy principles here? These methods, that is energy methods, are extensively used for determination of force or any internal stress resultant. Maybe we will be calling it as bending moment, the shear force, etc., and displacement of structures. Correct. So these energy principles are most important to structural analysis, not only for solving displacement and unknown reactions, but also in developing some of the basic concepts of structural analysis. These principles express the relationship between the stresses, strains or deformations, displacements, material properties and external effects in the form of energy or work done by internal and external forces. So this will be working on the law of conservation of energy. So we'll discuss in brief in later slides. So ultimately this energy principles will be working on external work done is equal to internal energy stored, that is external work is W is equal to internal energy stored is U. Okay, so these energy principles are most important in structural analysis, not only for finding displacement and reactions, but also in developing the basic concepts of structural analysis. So first let us see what exactly this strain energy is. Okay, before that let me take any particular structural component. So let us say a beam. Okay, so beam is subjected to different types of loadings, maybe a concentrated load, maybe a UDL, maybe a UVL, or a combination of loads. Correct. So when these different types of loadings acting on a particular beam, the beam will be subjected to deflection or deformation. Correct. So the external loads are there, they will be causing the beam to deform. So in doing so, what will be happening over there? So external work is doing. Correct. So external work is done over there. Due to the external loads, the deformation, load into deformation, nothing but work done. There will be external work done. Correct. So but do you think the beam will be deformed? No, obviously not. Why? So it is designed in a such a way that it is resisting the external loads. Correct. So when it is resisting the external load, means there will be again internal work done. What is that? The internal forces will be developed. Those internal forces will be doing the work done, force into displacement. I hope it is clear. Correct. So a beam subjected to external loads, so will be making the external work done. In the same fashion, the internal forces will be developed, then they will be doing the internal work done. Okay, so this is nothing but the law of conservation of energy. So ultimately the external work done must be equal to the internal work done. So in general, if you have seen with respect to physics, the law of conservation of energy is nothing but the energy neither be created nor stored, but it can be transferred from one form to another, correct? So the same thing if we apply with respect to the structures, the external, the loads acting on a particular structure will be causing the external work done. That is, when an external load acts on a structure, the structure undergoes deformation and hence the work is done. To resist these external forces, the internal forces develop gradually from zero to their final value and the work is again done internally. So what will be the internal forces? Maybe a bending moment, maybe a shear force, maybe a axial force, maybe a torsional moment, maybe a twisting moment, etc. Due to the external load, these are all the types of internal forces developed. Those internal forces will be doing the work done. Correct? This internal work done is stored as energy in the structure and it helps the structure to spring back to the original shape and size. Whenever the external loads are removed, provided the material of the structure is still within the elastic limit, then it can regain its original shape and size. Correct? With respect to this, the internal stored energy, so we can define what is strain energy. The internal work which is stored as energy is due to the straining of the material and hence is called as strain energy. Okay, so in other words, here we have written it is the energy stored in the material in the form of deformation or strain by the load. Okay, some points with respect to strain energy. So an elastic material will utilize the energy to regain the original shape and size. So if it is elastic material, again it will regain its original shape and size. The strain energy stored in a material will be equal to the total work done by the load on the material. Then again, strain energy is the internal energy which is stored in any material when it is loaded within its elastic limit. Correct? So the external loads causing the strain energy. Okay, that is internal energy which is stored. So that beam is not having any deflection due to the external load. It is at static position, correct? Because of it is developing the internal energy. So this strain energy is also called as the work done by a loaded material, correct? So load is there. Then it is also called as, in general, resilience. Okay, the other word for strain energy is nothing but resilience. This resilience nothing but the internal energy stored in a material. Correct? So this unit of this strain energy, either it will be Newton meter, kilonewton meter, Newton millimeter, kilonewton millimeter. So why it is Newton meter or kilonewton meter, something like this? So ultimately, what is this energy? The internal work done. What is work done? Force into displacement. What is the unit of force? It is Newton or kilonewton. Then what is the unit of displacement? Either it is millimeter or meter. So with respect to that, the unit of this may be Newton meter, kilonewton meter, Newton millimeter, kilonewton millimeter. Then again, strain energy depends on applied load. Obviously, strain energy to be stored, material must deform within elastic limit. Okay, so strain energy principles is used in springs. You are aware about spring. So the spring, you can explain the strain energy principles. Okay, when the load is removed on that particular spring, if you consider for example, then material will regain its original shape. The load applied on the material can be gradually applied load, or it might be suddenly applied load, or it might be impact load. These things with respect to spring analysis. So already you have learned the basic about this strain energy and strength of material, correct? So let us see what is strain energy and complementary energy. So this is the figure wherein it is subjected to different types of loadings. Okay, those loads are nothing but the external loads. So these loads will be causing the work done, the external work done. So when it is causing the external work done, simultaneously the internal forces will be developing. So those internal forces will also be causing the work done. So ultimately, law of conservation of energy, external work done must be equal to the internal work done. If you plot the load and deformation graph of this particular thing, that is stress strain relationship. Okay, so this is the behavior of particular material. Okay, the stress strain relationship shown from this particular graph. So if you consider any particular element in this particular body, so for that, if you draw this stress strain relationship, it is something like this. So the area below this is called as strain energy. The opposite, that is area above this line or a curve, is called as complementary energy. So the area below this is strain energy here. The area other side is complementary energy. Okay, so usually what happens when work done by a load, suppose P, which is applied suddenly, okay, if you it is applied suddenly, is given by usually W is equal to P into delta. So that is force into displacement, where delta is the deformation produced by the load on the material. Okay, so for that you can draw the stress strain relationship for the entire thing work done. It will be something like this rectangle. So entire thing, that is for sudden load. Okay, if the load is applied gradually, then the work done will be, so you will consider the half into force into displacement when it is applied gradually. So you need to take the average of all the loads. So half average load, that is a half into P is the load and delta, correct? So why it is average load? Gradually you are applying the load from 0 to some values, correct? 0 plus P by 2, nothing but half into P into delta L, that is called as average load, correct? So again, the energy stored below this curve, that is low deflection curve, is strain energy, and here it is complementary energy. So if you see the definition here, strain energy is defined as the energy stored in a body due to deformation. The strain energy per unit volume is known as strain energy density, and the area under the stress strain curve towards the point of deformation, when the applied forces is released, the whole system returns to its original shape. So this is the deformation. So deformation, towards deformation, this area is strain energy. A complementary energy, the area enclosed by the inclined line, so this line, and the vertical axis, this vertical axis, is called the complementary energy. For linearly elastic materials, the complementary energy and elastic strain energy are same. So this will not be a curved line, so it will be a straight line. When for linearly elastic materials, if I draw the stress strain relationship, so it will be a straight line. So directly the complementary energy and strain energy, they will be equal. Okay, so we need to discuss about some derivations, that is for standard cases. So what will be the strain energy, that is work done by the internal forces, stored energy, due to the different application of loads on a particular structure. Okay, so let us derive the expressions for strain energy to the following standard cases. Strain energy in a body due to applied axial force. These are the three standard cases. Apart from this, you need to discuss about the torsion also. Axial force, bending moment. So this bending moment is nothing but, again, in general, moment, couple, a flexure force. Okay, then shear. Okay, so let us discuss the strain energy in a body due to axial force. So let us consider a straight bar. Okay, let us consider a straight bar of length L having uniform cross-sectional area A. Okay, so then in an this particular uniform bar, straight bar, or you can say a beam or So let us consider bar, because already in strength of material we have derived this due to the axial force, a bar subjected to axial force, correct? So if you consider this as a bar subjected to axial force P, okay, what will happen? So due to the application of this force P, axial force, there will be a deformation here, that is nothing but delta, correct? So a bar, okay, one end is fixed, other end is free, so you are applying the axial force, okay, that is having the deformation delta. This is the dotted line showing with dotted lines, that is nothing but the deformation, okay. In an axial load P, when it is applied gradually and if the bar undergoes a deformation delta, the work done will be stored as strain energy U. So here, so this particular force P is doing the work done, and that work done will be after deformation, strain energy will be, in general, strain energy denoted with U, capital U, is equal to half into P into delta. So what is this half? That is nothing but the average force, okay. The strain energy will be equal to the average force, that is half into P multiplied by the deformation, that is delta, okay. This is the strain energy stored in that particular bar, okay. So by Hooke's law you are already aware about this. So this particular deformation is nothing but PL over AE, where A is the cross sectional area and E is the Young's modulus of the material, correct? So in strength of material, by Hooke's law, delta, the deformation is PL over AE. So if you substitute this delta, so in this equation, so what we will be getting, so ultimately strain energy will equal to, so this P into P, P square into L divided by 2AE, this 2 and 2A into E, okay. So applying this strain energy equation for element dx, so let us consider in this bar an element dx, okay. Why we need to consider an element dx? This particular bar has variable in cross section, so it may not be a straight line, okay. It may be having some different cross sections. If that is the case, okay, so for that reason we need to consider a small section of length dx, and area of cross section let us consider it as ax, okay. The strain energy for this particular element only dx is given by du, okay. Strain energy for this element dx is equal to du is equal to p square into dx divided by 2 ax into e. This is ax because we are considering ax for this elemental area, okay. So then total strain energy throughout the bar, okay. So if you want to consider the strain energy only this for elemental area, since the the area of cross section is different, so for that reason if you are considering an elemental area, so this is given by p square into dx divided by 2ae. So if you want for the entire bar, then you need to integrate it within the limits, let us say 0 to L. So U is equal to total strain energy throughout the bar will be U is equal to integration of 0 to L P square into dx divided by 2AE. Okay. So this will be the strain energy stored in a body due to axial force. Okay. I hope it is clear what we have done. We have considered a bar, one end is fixed, other end is subjected to load P. So deformation, so Hooke's law we have equated, then strain energy stored will be ultimately U is equal to 0 to L P square dx divided by 2AE. Similarly, so we need to derive the expression for strain energy in a body due to bending or nothing but flexure or is a couple, okay. So again let us consider a member of length L. So this is the length L, okay. So let us consider a member of length L subjected to uniform bending moment M, okay. When it will be subjected to uniform bending moment, so it is subjected to some loadings. It may be a UDL, it may be a concentrated load, it may be a UVL, okay. So this particular beam is subjected to different types of loadings, so those loadings will be causing the bending moment or bending or a moment in this particular beam. Okay, so that is subjected to uniform bending moment, M, capital M. Consider an element of length dx. Okay, so this is an element length of dx, and let d theta be the change in the slope of the element due to the applied moment M. Okay, so if you consider only a part of this particular beam dx at a distance x, okay, similar to the moment area theorems when we are discussing about the moment area theorem, so with respect to that, okay, so here let me take the pen. Okay, this particular, this dx element, if I consider, this is subjected to a moment, correct? So this is M. Okay, this is subjected to moment, this M, this is also M, a couple. Okay, so wherein, so okay, so if I draw the tangent at these points, so it is the change in slope, correct? The change in slope of the element due to applied moment M will be d theta, correct? If M is applied gradually, correct? So from 0 to gradually to the maximum. Okay, strain energy stored in a small element will be given by, that is, load on the beam produces bending moment M on the element dx, in turn produces strain energy, that is du for this particular element dx, is given by average bending moment into angular rotation, correct? So the strain energy will be the average bending moment, then angular rotation. Okay, so that is nothing but du is equal to half into m into d theta. Let us call this as equation number one. Okay, the strain energy due to bending moment. Okay, so for this elemental length dx. Okay, already by while discussing the moment area theorems, we have discussed. So what is theta? This theta is nothing but dy dx, that is slope dy by dx. If I substitute theta as dy by dx, so ultimately we will be getting d square y upon dx square. So this d square y upon dx square is equal to what? M by EI. If you remember the moment area theorem, so M by EI is equal to d square y upon dx square from that. Okay, so d theta equal to, ultimately, so this d theta is equal to M by EI into dx, correct? D theta by dx is equal to M by EI, so d theta equal to M by EI into dx. That is equation number two. Substituting this equation two in equation one, the strain energy in dx length is given by du is equal to M square divided by 2EI into dx. Okay, so this is for an elemental length dx. So total strain energy in the entire beam of length L from here to here. Okay, then we need to integrate within the limits 0 to L. So you will be getting M square by 2EI into dx. Okay, this is very much important expression. From this you will be finding the deflection of beams. Okay, so remember this, total strain energy in the entire beam due to the bending or flexure is given by M square by 2EI within the limits 0 to L. Okay, then strain energy in a body due to shear. Similarly, we need to discuss or derive the strain energy stored in a body due to shear. Again, let us consider a cantilever beam. Let us say this as a cantilever beam. Okay, so this is having the length L as shown in figure. Again, consider an elemental length dx. Okay, so let this elemental length dx subjected to the shear. Okay, oh, yes, okay, this is the shear force. Okay, if shear here acting, so this is nothing but subjected to shear VV, so elemental length dx. Okay, so if this is the case, Okay, consider an element length dx. So here v will be the shear force. If v is applied gradually, the strain energy stored in the element will be, okay, so load on the beam produces shear force on element dx. So here in turn produces the strain energy, that is for this du is equal to average shear force, okay, into shear deformation for this element length dx due to shear force v. Okay, so this shear force into shear deformation, correct? So du is equal to half into v into delta. Let us call this as equation number one. So again, so strength of material you have already learnt. So this deformation, that is delta, is nothing but shear stress divided by shear modulus, tau divided by g, where this shear stress is shear force divided by cross sectional area, that is v by a. So again, hence for element dx, okay, the deformation, again if you substitute back, v divided by ag, so delta is equal to tau divided by g, so where tau is v by a. So if you substitute, delta is equal to this v by ag in this expression. So this is equation number two, where a is cross sectional area, okay, and v is shear force and g is shear modulus, correct? So strength of materials from that. Substitute this equation two in equation number one here again. So delta value, if you substitute, so ultimately you'll be getting v square divided by 2ag into dx for this elemental length, the strain energy produced due to the shear force. Okay, so total strain energy for this entire beam 0 to L, that is U is equal to 0 to L V square divided by 2ag into dx. Okay, similar to bending moment. Okay, so next, similarly, strain energy in torsion. So the element ds, okay, consider an element ds subjected to torque T. When you call about the torsion, so it is subjected to torque, okay, the rotation. Okay, so then there will be an angle of twist. So this is the angle of twist d theta. So by strain energy produced will be, work done will be half into t into d theta, that is the twist, okay, angle of twist into torque. But from the theory of simple torsion, so by strength of material already, so this t by j, where j is the polar moment of inertia, is equal to g into d theta by ts. Ds is the length of the element, okay, where g is the shear modulus of the material, okay, or else d theta is equal to t into ds by g theta. So ultimately total strain energy resulting from torsion will be 0 to L t square. If you substitute, t square divided by 2 into ds divided by g into j, okay. So this is the strain energy expression for torsion, t square into L divided by 2 into g j for the entire length of the member. Okay, yes, the summary, ultimately these theorems, so whatever we have discussed, the strain energy expressions, okay, so strain energy due to axial force, bending and shear, so u is equal to strain energy expression 0 to L 0 to L 0 to L for axial force, p square divided by 2ae into dx, for bending m square divided by 2ei into dx, for shear v square divided by 2ag into dx. So note the similarity in pattern of the formulas. Okay, so here if you see the axial force, in the denominator it is ae. Okay, so when you say axial force, so there is a cross sectional area and Young's modulus. When you say a bending, then it is the material properties, the Young's modulus and moment of inertia. Okay, when you say a shear, then there will be rigidity modulus and cross-sectional, reduced cross-sectional area, correct? So then let us start solving the problems by strain energy method first. So this is the calculation procedure for beams and frames under flexure. Okay, so step one, obtain the expression for bending moment at a certain section xx, that is m is equal to f of x. Okay, so any particular beam is given, okay, cantilever beam or simply supported beam. So cut a section at a distance xx, okay, find what is the moment at that xx. Okay, second step, using that expression, find total strain energy in a structure. So u is equal to 0 to L m square divided by 2EI into dx, because you are finding the moment. Due to moment, strain energy stored in a member is given by m square divided by 2EI into dx. Then third step, using the relation, that is strain energy U is equal to half into P into delta, that is the work done. So obtain unknown displacement delta, correct? So these are the three steps you will be using to find deflection by strain energy method. Okay, so let us discuss once again the total strain energy method. When external forces are applied to a beam or a structure, the structure deforms. The external forces perform work and the energy stored in the structure in the form of stress or elastic deformation, correct? So in associated with this, the law of conservation of energy, the total work done in the small movements of the external forces must be equal to the potential energy that is stored in the structure due to the external forces. This internal stored energy due to the straining of the body or the structure is called strain energy. When the external forces are removed, the beams or the structures rebounds elastically and the stored potential energy returns to zero. Okay, the strain energy of a beam due to bending is given by that expression. Ultimately, U is equal to 0 to L m square by 2 EI into dx. So we will be using that expression to solve the problems or to find the deflection by strain energy method. So ultimately, we know that. So external work done W must be equal to internal work done U. W is equal to U. So that is the main thing where we will be concentrating. Okay, so work done, W is equal to U, that U is nothing but half into P into delta. So with that, so even let us see this back. For trusses, the procedure. So for truss, the same thing, find the support reactions, determine the forces in the various members using method of joints or method of sections. Ultimately, you need to find what all the forces in the members of the trusses. Then find the strain energy stored in the truss. Okay, so here you need to note some points. So this method is used to find the deflection below the point load only, that is strain energy method we are talking about. This method is applicable when a single concentrated load is acting on the beam or frame. Here deflection is denoted by delta. Okay, so let us solve one particular problem on a cantilever beam using strain energy method. Okay, example one, using strain energy method, determine the deflection of the free end of a cantilever of length L subject to a concentrated load P at the free end. Okay, this is a cantilever beam where one end is fixed, other end is free, subjected to point load P, a concentrated load P at the free end. This is free end. Okay, so you need to solve this problem wherein you are finding the deflection at the free end due to the force P by strain energy method. Okay, so step one. So ultimately what we have discussed, so you need to find the moment at a distance xx. Okay, so in cantilever beam, always you will consider from the free end a distance x here. From the free end a distance x. Okay, this is the section xx. Okay, what is the moment at this? The bending moment at a distance x from the free end is m is equal to p into x. Correct, p into x. Strain energy is given by 0 to L m square divided by 2EI into dx. Step 2, that is strain energy. So we have written, so this m square, nothing but m already we have found, that is p into x. Moment is p into x. So substitute here m, that is p square x square, because it is m square. So p square x square divided by 2ei as it is into dx. So again, if you integrate this, okay, so p is the force, so that is variable p square as it is 2ei. So x integration is x cube by 3 within the limit 0 to L. So strain energy, what you are getting? So p square, so if you substitute L, so p square L cube divided by 3 to the 6 ER. So this is the strain energy. Okay, step 1, we have found the moment at a section XX at a distance X from the free end. Then strain energy, this is the standard expression. So substituted the moment value, then integrate it within the limit 0 to L. So we have taken the moment at a distance x if it is for the entire length. Okay, so 0 to L, strain energy will be p square L cube by 6 EI. Okay, step 3, that is strain energy stored in the member must be equal to total work done. So what is strain energy? So p square L cube by 6 EI, this must be equal to the work done. So that is half into p into delta. So this is standard, correct? The average load, half of p into deformation work done, force into deformation, the force due to the average load when it is applied gradually, correct? So if you equate this to, so delta will be pl cube by 3ei. Okay, this is standard equation, what you can say, standard expression for concentrated load acting on the free end for the cantilever beam. The deflection at the free end will be pl cube by 3ei. So here the deflection you are finding about the point load, below the point load, you need to remember that. Okay, so the notes we have already discussed, correct? This method is used to find the deflection below the point load only, correct? So here we are finding the deflection, that is pl cube by 3ei. Okay, let us stop it here. So in next class we can discuss few more problems. Thank you.